Good afternoon. Thank you very much for coming to hear about health and healthcare. It's a little different than the Beatles. But what I wanted to share with you today, I wanted to start off just talking a little bit and giving you an example and a quote from Winston Churchill, who said that healthy citizens are the greatest asset that a country can have. Those words are more true now, today, than they have ever been before. Our country is reinvigorated and refocused on health, health care, health promotion. And what we know now is that we have a significant challenge ahead of us. While we are focusing and refocusing on health, we are also facing the most significant shortage of healthcare providers than ever before. The federal government has identified healthcare shortage areas in the country, and they've identified 6,000 of them. In order to be identified as a healthcare shortage area, there needs to be one provider for 3,500 people. Well, I don't really like those odds. I wouldn't want to be living in an area of 3,500 people and only one provider. And we have 6,000 of those in our country right now. For primary care physicians, right now we have an estimated 70,000 openings for primary care physicians in our country. That's expected to increase to 90,000 by 2020 and 130,000 by 2025. That's quite a loss for us. For nurses, it's even worse. It is estimated that by 2020, we will have a shortage of 1.2 million nurses. And that's not even counting the 500,000 of us that are aging and will be retiring between now and 2020. We're fortunate in Rochester. We don't have a nursing shortage here in Rochester because we have many schools of nursing, and we have plenty of positions for them. But this is what is looming in our future. So what are we going to do? How are we going to face the healthcare issues, knowing that as of October 1st, millions more of Americans are now having access to healthcare? How are we going to meet that challenge? Well, we are going to start to meet it by working as a team. We can't provide the care on our own. We need to work as a team. It's not just physicians, and it's not just nurses. It is teams that include pharmacists, social workers, biomedical engineers, information technologists, other healthcare workers, community outreach workers. It takes a team. As a nurse practitioner, when I provide care, I don't provide care just because I think it is the best way to do something. My care that I provide is based on evidence and what the research tells me is the best care to provide. And what we know from the evidence, what we know from research, is that when patients are cared for by a team of providers, that their care is most cost-effective, it has greater efficiency, and it blossoms with innovation, because you have more than one person providing that care. It is no longer a pyramid of care providers where one provider's on top and all the other providers are below. It is a team of providers, really almost forming a circle. And what is in that circle, the middle of the circle, the bullseye, is the patient. The patient and the family are at the center of all we do. And all the other providers are around that patient. And we call that patient family-centered care. The best care we can provide now, and we know that from the evidence, is when it is patient and family-centered. In addition to providing care as a team, there's other things that we need to do. We need to support graduate medical education. There is legislation that is concerning that might be cutting the funding for graduate medical education. And that is significant. It is very costly for a hospital to have medical students and residents and fellows as part of the team, and we need to ensure that that legislation does not decrease the funding for graduate medical education. We need to encourage our medical students to choose primary care. It's not as sexy as cardiology or neurosurgery or some of the other specialty practices, but primary care is what we need. We also need to focus our attention on the scope of practice for nurse practitioners. There are 13 states in the country that allow nurse practitioners to practice independently. New York State is not one of them. For nurse practitioners, their scope of practice is that they can provide primary care to a wide continuum of patients. The Institute of Medicine has recommended that nurse practitioners need to be allowed to practice to the full extent of their education, and that includes primary care. We need to ensure that that happens. And lastly, we need to ensure that our providers are being taught through interprofessional education practices. What does that mean? The World Health Organization has identified that interprofessional education is when two or more disciplines learn with, from, and about each other. So instead of educating in silos, medical students learn one way, nursing students learn another way, pharmacists learn another way, we all learn information together. At the medical center, we have just recently formed the Institute for Innovative Education, where we are doing just that. We're looking at all the providers across the whole healthcare system, and we are educating certain concepts and certain information across the board, all in one room, but also then all in the areas in which they're practicing. Just recently, we provided a Team STEPS training, which is a national training program to prevent errors in healthcare, as well as to increase the quality and safety of healthcare. And we provided that curriculum to our medical students and nursing students together. They were second-year medical students and our first-year nursing students. So they went through scenarios together, they decided how they were going to care for this patient over that patient, and what different things they were going to do together. And we were one of the first schools in the country that brought those two groups of students together, and as they graduate, they will be certified Team STEPS providers. Shortly after that training, just a few weeks ago, as I was walking through the atrium of our School of Nursing, which I do every morning coming from the parking lot, in our School of Nursing, we have about 650 students, and I try to get to know who they are, and if I don't know them personally, I do recognize them at least. And as I was walking through the school, there was a group of students that were studying together, and I recognized this one gentleman. I didn't recognize the one gentleman, actually, but as he was studying with the students, and actually I saw him the one day, and I saw him again the next day, and on day three, I thought, I need to find out who this young man is. So I went up to him and I said, I'm sorry, I don't recognize you. Can you tell me what program you're in or what you're studying? And he said, looked really cautiously, and he said, I know that you're the dean of the school. And he said, but I'm not one of your students. And I said, you're not. And in a whisper, he said, I'm a medical student. I said, a medical student? I'm not going to collapse over that. This is wonderful that you're here. And he said, well, I just learned Team STEPS training with the nursing students just a couple weeks ago, and we really started to engage in what we have been learning, and we're all learning the different things, but we're learning about the same thing. We're learning about how to take care of a patient and family in the best way that we possibly can. And I said, well, you are more than welcome to stay here and study with my nursing students. And he said, well, if you go up to the second floor, there's more of us up there too. And I said, oh, this is wonderful. And as I went to the third floor where my office is, I sat down and realized that we are creating a brand new generation of healthcare providers. And I called Dean Taubman, the dean of the medical school, and I said, this is it. This is exactly what we have wanted. We have wanted to teach our students together. We want them to learn with each other. We want them to learn about each other. but more importantly, we want them to learn together how you work as a team, how you provide care as a team, because we know that that is the very best thing for our patients and families. So I feel very confident, as Winston Churchill had said, that our healthy citizens are the greatest asset a country can have. And I am convinced that we are doing just that in teaching our providers together so that they can work together as a team so that our citizens will remain healthy. Thank you very much.